I was a class 11 kid preparing for India when all this action was happening. And I remember those photographs which came post the damage of those airfields and as well as the naval strikes that took place. Now, sir, on the first and second night of the war, there were two massive Canberra raids, each aircraft carrying 8,000 kg bombs. But they failed to put out those two airfields of Dhaka, Kormitola and Desna. But after 2 days, on the 6th of December, strikes by the MiGs and Hunters did the trick. Now, where was the flaw? Two questions. Why did this happen? And would you agree that the vision to put down the airfields existed, but we somehow lacked in our execution at that point?
Because we took 2 days for the air dominance to come.
Well, yes, we are, it should have been the first objective for us. And with that, once the war started on 3rd, with the attacks in the west, we sent in these Canberras, and because they were vulnerable by day, they could only operate by night. And while these 8 Canberras against Desgaon and Kormitola carried 8,000 pound bombs, as far as I know, that's a lot of tonnage. Their accuracy in level bombing from medium altitudes of 6,000 to 8,000 feet above the attack level was not really good enough, shall I say. And we should have known that. You know, we should have known that from the Battle of Britain and all the other places. The size of the bombing or medium level bombing does not do pinpoint damage to what we want. I mean, it's okay for area bombing, but not for pinpoint targets. Then, in the first day or day and a half, actually, Kamal unfortunately had decided that we will all go to Earth. For what reason, I don't understand for. Because we had such numerical superiority, as I mentioned, even with 6 squadrons against 1. And because of that, at low level, we were actually out of gas, you know, most of us. From Ashimar and I, we had no combat fuel reserves. We had cut into our diversionary fuel. And we were carrying only 4 tankers with internal guns. And I still remember, you know, this argument in our crew rooms in about June 1971 as to what are we going to do with these guns, pepper the runway, or we expect them to line up the sabers outside for us, you know, to pick on them. Unfortunately, we went like that. And quite frankly, I had written about it earlier and I had advocated that with this kind of superiority, we should have all got it medium to high levels with bombs. And if the sabers came up to meet us, we could have jettisoned our load and engaged them in aircraft. We were okay with numerical superiority and shot them down in the air. And if they didn't come up to meet us, then we could have carried on bombing the runway from day one. And possibly with that, we could have achieved air superiority not in 2 days, not in 48 hours, or whatever, when we started the bombing later, but perhaps in the first wave of 2 hours.
These are lessons to be learned, and you know, many of the lessons from 65 were brought on in this war. And there was a significant improvement in the close air support, or battlefield airstrikes as we call them now, vis-a-vis the 65 war. So why is that? What had changed between 65 and 71 that was better?
Well, I must mention before I go on to the close air support that from 65, one of the lessons that we had learned because of the high losses on the ground, we lost some 36 aircraft on the ground in 65 to Pakistani air attacks. And because of that, I think the hangover, our focus was still on air defense, you know, gaps around the airfields to protect them. Now, that was okay for the West, where we had, and even the MASH force, and they could have attacked us like they did, try on third evening. But in the East, where there was a single squadron, right, and which did not carry out any preemptive attacks on the third evening, and the rest of the West, they carried it out. We should have known that actually there was no threat to our airfields at all, right, and we could have even taken the air defense effort into counter air and other close air support missions. Now, one of the major lessons that we learned was that the coordination between the Army and the Air Force and the communication of the infrastructure or the structure that was put in place in 65 was more adequate to carry out good cooperation or give them adequate closure support. So Air Chief Marshal P.C. Rao, who was the Vice Chief in 65, and I must give credit to him, he had actually built up this tactical air center with almost every corps and every sector, and he had even nominated squadrons which will support the army in that particular sector, and there was a lot of emphasis on this. We also had very qualified and forward air controllers, fighter pilots actually, because as it happened after the bulge of 62 and beyond, we had surplus pilots in the squadrons. So these fighter pilots were put in almost every brigade, I would say, if not divisions, but particularly brigades, and they were available with the army to coordinate and control the close air support missions. Now that led to two good things. You know, these guys were familiar with the area, they were familiar with the squadrons where they come from and the people in there, so they could control them much better without any possibility or least possibility of interference or jamming or fake articles, directing them somewhere else. So this was the improvement in the entire report structure, which led to such high support. And even on the first day, actually, we carried out the counter air. If I remember correctly, there were some 55 sorties that were devoted to close air support and battlefield air support that we called. Yes, and from the second year onward, this doubled almost to 110 and 11, and carried on like that till about the 8th or 9th. And then, because the army was moving rapidly and there was very little opposition, there were times when we had aircraft sitting on the ground waiting for some demand from the army.
That's correct. Yes, I remember that, reading somewhere that the percentage of the sorties put in towards close air support was something like 60% or something like that. I may be wrong with the exact numbers.
No, you're right. It was something like 1,350 sorties in the east out of a total of 2,000. About 68% or something like that was devoted to army support.
Of army support. Okay, so finally, when you come down to it, so what did air dominance bring to the army jawan on ground? What he always likes to see his own aircraft over it. But did air dominance bring that, or was it something else?
Well, I'm a proponent of saying that the best way we can support the army is where they don't see enemy aircraft and they don't see our own aircraft, because we are busy keeping the enemy air force pinned down somewhere else. So in this particular case, complete air dominance that we had at the east achieved by the 6th meant that the army and the navy also, I would put it this way, and even the air force elements could move and do what they wanted to without fear of an air attack. I mean, if you remember Boina and the attacks by the sabers over there for 2-3 days, the army was complaining that there were no air force available to protect them. So frankly, this is what gave the freedom of movement by day, night, at the time of their choosing, at the place of their choosing, to the entire force. And that is what I must mention, General Sagar, commanding 4 Corps, capitalized on very quickly with the Meghna Elamon operation and got across the Meghna River to the West Bank and beyond and started approaching Dhaka. Even the paradrop of Tangail on the 11th was made possible because of this dominance in the air. And I will put it this way, that if we didn't have dominance in the air, I don't think we could have completed the campaign, which was called a Blitzkrieg or Lightning campaign, in the time that we did, and which led to the surrender of Dhaka. Because if the progress was slow, there was likelihood that the international pressure will enforce a ceasefire, and after we would be left where we were. And one of the army seekers that I must mention over here, on 13th of December, issued by army headquarters, General Manekshaw, asked the army to go back and reoccupy all the strong points that they had bypassed earlier, which, without mentioning Dhaka. So which meant that actually we would have been left with a certain amount of territory of Bangladesh, but not the entire liberation of the country as we had, we should have aimed for.
So in conclusion, sir, the governor strike by, you know, which while the meeting was on, brought in, you know, a quick closure, avoided unnecessary bloodletting. So in conclusion, sir, your final thoughts on what led to the lightning victories that we finally got?
Well, I think there were three essential elements that led to this, the success of the, or the victory in the manner it came about. First was air dominance, right? Because without that, nothing would have moved. That was the basic foundation on which the entire operation could progress, basically, and we built on. The second was, I would say, the capitalization and the innovative and aggressive thinking by General Sagar, who, with a small force of helicopters that were available for them, I think there were 13 or 14 Mi-4s, full Mi-4s, out of which 10 or 11 were available at any one time. He not only put a battalion, 4x5 GR, across at Sillet to block those brigades over there within that area on the 7th of December, but from the 9th, he jumped across the Meghna River, which was not his task, and then went across, towards in the race to Dhaka. So General Sagat's move was the second one, supported by the paragraph of two para under a very flamboyant and very aggressive commander called Lieutenant Colonel K.S. Pandu, Gurvinder Singh Pandu, who later became a Lieutenant General. And the 101 bomb zone led by a very able Major General Nakra at that particular time. The third, I think, was key, where we dealt a death blow to the crumbling regime in the East, was this strike on the governor's house on the 14th, which came about very suddenly and showed the reaction, the way the Air Force reacts to this kind of intelligence in quick time. I mean, I believe by about 10:30 the information had come in the morning on 14th that there was going to be a meeting by Governor White in the governor's house with all the high officials and even UN officials. And four hunters from Hasinara from my squadron, which I was a part, and four MiGs from 28 Squadron and Guard were tasked to carry out an attack on this governor's house at that particular time when the meeting was in progress. And you can imagine how quickly we reacted, because we had no maps, we had no locations of where the governor's house actually was in Dhaka. And surprisingly, and very funnily, we found a tourist map of a Second World War vintage by Burma Chef, which actually gave the layout, and we went to that place and we attacked it successfully. And I can only say later that I read that the attacks were so pinpoint without any collateral damage and so effective that Governor Malik on the spot took out a piece of paper and wrote his resignation and moved to the Japan Hotel immediately. We followed this up with a strike on the university the next day, where the rest of the army was hiding, we were told, basically conveying a message that you can run, but you can't hide. And this psychological blow to a crumbling regime is what brought it down and what perhaps forced these three things combined, of being enveloped from all sides by the army and being attacked by the air from anywhere, which led to the surrender. And I must end with one thought here, which clarified the General Niazi, when he was asked at the surrender ceremony by AOC in Syria, East Senate Command, Air Marshal Dewan, as to why he surrendered when there are so many people and so many troops, 30,000-40,000 within Dhaka itself available and could have continued the fight. And General Niazi is supposed to have pointed at the chest of Group Captain Chandan Singh on his wings and said, "This is what made us surrender." Saying words like that, "We tried to get some rest and recuperate and to be able to fight, but the Air Force didn't let us go."
Thank you very much, sir. We need to wind up. We can just continue with those stories. So in nutshell, sir, what I would say is that the air campaign, both in the East and the West, brought out the importance of human ingenuity, thinking and working under pressure. The pressure of time and the pressure of the fact that if you don't perform or the machine doesn't perform, then there are consequences at the national level. Decentralized execution, which was there. And finally, sir, since I commanded Guwahati and we have ACS of space here, We have a helicopter out there, but that MiG-21, which was there, which struck during the governor's house, if that comes up in Air Force Station Guwahati, that would be wonderful. It was a wonderful session, and I need to close. I can see a hand up, but I don't think we have any more time because there is another speaker waiting in UK to come along with Rana Chena. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you for those thoughts and those memories.
Thank you.